I'm going to share my presentation here. I hope my presentation is visible.
Yes, sir.
And I am audible also clearly.
Yes, absolutely.
So, I am going to talk on the understanding of diabetes and the management in next about 20 minutes time that is allocated to me. I don't have any disclosures for this presentation, but my job has been made much easier now by two brilliant presentations from Dr. Neeta and Dr. Rucha, taking care of the understanding of obesity as well as the lifestyle interventions for the obesity. Now, coming to diabetes is nothing but concurrence of type 2 diabetes and obesity. And this term was first coined by Ethan Sims and colleagues in 1973. The reason is that two diseases are linked by various pathophysiological mechanisms, which revolve around insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia. And part of this was highlighted by Dr. Neeta's presentation. And there is a very strong correlation between weight gain and development of disease. And every kg increase in weight is associated with about 4% increase in the risk of diabetes. So we have currently the diabetes epidemic or twin epidemic of type 2 diabetes and obesity. And in this presentation at this point of time, I would also like to clarify that term diabetes in this presentation is being used synonymously with type 2 diabetes. This has been labeled as possibly the biggest epidemic in human history, and it cannot be ignored by any means. So in this presentation, first I will touch upon briefly the magnitude of problem, what causes diabetes, whether it is genetics and environmental factors. Some of it has been already covered, and then management part. So if you look at the data, over the last four decades, the worldwide prevalence of obesity has nearly tripled. There are almost 40% adults globally who are overweight, and almost 13% of the adult population is obese. Now, this increase in prevalence is much higher in children and adolescents, and has increased by 4.5 times, largely affecting the Asia and developing countries. In India, we have 1 in 5 adults who are overweight. And if we look at the prevalence of obesity, there is almost 20% adult women and men are obese as on date. What causes obesity? Beautifully, explained by Dr. Neeta, the interplay between the genetic factors and environmental factors leading to a complex, mechanisms involving the central regulation as well as peripheral signaling coming from gut and adipose tissue. Now, as long as there is balance between the caloric intake and expenditure, the weight is going to be stable. But this imbalance has, occurred over majorly last four decades. And we have seen there is a marked increase in prevalence of obesity as well as diabetes over last four decades. So if you look at the genetic factors, actually genes do not change over decades or, centuries. It takes more than centuries for the genetic mutations to happen. But the environmental factors have changed tremendously over the last four decades. And we know there has been increase in mechanization, easy availability of transportation, easy availability of so many tools of communication, and decreased physical activity. And of course, there is increasing affluence. As Shashank Joshi says, that we are suffering from affluenza. We have more availability of food, high calorie foods, and this is leading to imbalance. Now, possibly these environmental factors are leading to change in the expression of these genes. And we know, it was shown by Dr. Neeta also, that there are more than 300 SNPs which have been recognized to be associated with FTO or obesity related gene, which possibly influence the expression of obesity phenotype in individuals. Now, the studies which looked at the gene by environment or lifestyle interactions have clearly shown that possibly increasingly obesogenic environment is amplifying the genetic risk for obesity. And within this environment also, those who are at higher risk can mitigate this risk by increasing physical activity and avoiding specific dietary components. And Dr. Rucha beautifully showed, you know, how you should manage your diet. So, fundamental cause of obesity is basically energy imbalance, and there has been change globally with decrease in energy expenditure and increase in availability of energy dense foods, and which is leading to increasing prevalence. And in India also, the prevalence of obesity has doubled in last 10 years. And as I already mentioned, 1 in 5 are obese. Now, if you look at the consumption of foods in India, across board, there is a high consumption of carbs, the energy dense foods, that is the oil, though the oil consumption is low in the lowest income group, but highest income group, it is the high consumption of not only oil, but milk and milk products also. Meat consumption in India is low because we are largely a vegetarian population, but we are consuming a lot of carbs and oil. And this is very interesting data, which has shown the trajectory of energy consumption over over 40 years between 1970s and 2000. And if you see, there has been decrease in energy consumption, total energy consumption in the rural population, while it has been stable more or less in the urban population. And though the energy consumption increased in the lowest group, that is the lowest socioeconomic strata in rural as well as urban population, overall there has been a stable or decrease in the energy consumption. So if there is increasing obesity in spite of reduction in energy intake, there has to be an increase in the prevalence of increase in the physical inactivity, which is leading to this prevalence of obesity in India. And if you look at the trends in protein consumption, they have decreased or remained stable both in urban and rural population. But if you look at the consumption of fat, it has gone up significantly over last three to four decades, both in rural and urban population. Also, there has been increase in expenditure on cable TV connections, petrol, transportation, which indicates again that there is increasing physical inactivity rather than increase in food consumption. So fundamental cause of energy imbalance in India appears to be increased intake of energy dense foods high in fat, coupled with increase in physical inactivity, which is possibly due to increasingly sedentary nature of many forms of work, changing modes of transportation, and increasing urbanization. And this is possibly leading to increasing prevalence in obesity in India. And we all know that Asian Indians have more body fat, more intra-abdominal fat, more subtruncal subcutaneous fat, and less muscle mass. So we have sarcopenic, obesity phenotype, and which is all conducive to development of type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular risk. And we also have studies to clearly show that we get the risk of, cardiovascular comorbidities at lower level of BMI and waist circumference. So what is the link between diabetes, that is type 2 diabetes, and obesity? So whenever we look at obese individual, we know that it is going to be associated with a number of comorbidities, and the association with diabetes is possibly the most prominent or most well-studied as long as obesity is concerned. And if you look at the comparison between risk for different diseases, it is the risk of diabetes that is increased greatest by the increase in prevalence of obesity. There are a number of studies which have clearly shown that across US or Australia, as the prevalence of obesity goes up, there is the increase in prevalence of diabetes. And this is the latest prevalence data of global increase in obesity paralleled by global increase in diabetes. Though I'm sure the colors in the lower panel have changed in this slide and they are not very appreciable, but the data is very clear that there is a strong link between the prevalence of obesity and type 2 diabetes, and this has been validated by a number of studies. So whenever there is a rise in prevalence of obesity, there is rise in prevalence of diabetes, and studies have clearly shown that 90% of diabetes patients, type 2 diabetes patients, have higher BMI, and obesity accounts for almost 3/4 of type 2 diabetes patients. To the extent that at one point of time, way back in 2000, it was proposed to redefine obesity, type 2 diabetes, as a diabesity or obesity-dependent diabetes mellitus by Nick Feiner and Arnie Astra, but this was somehow not, you know, finally accepted. So what leads to this metabolic state in obesity? To understand this, we have to understand how fat is stored in body. So there is excess energy largely stored as triglyceride in adipose tissues, which is made available in time of need, such as starvation or during exercise. And white adipose tissue can store this energy by either increasing the number or increasing the size of adipocytes. In obese individuals, there is increase in size of adipocytes, where the adipose or tissue, the fat becomes very tightly, you know, compressed within the cell, leading to stress within the adipocytes and inflammation, leading to secretion of inflammatory cytokines. So if the excess calorie is stored as increase in or adipocyte hypertrophy, leading to inflammation and insulin resistance, there is development of metabolic resistance. However, some of the patients will remain healthy despite excess fat if they are able to increase the number of cells without causing inflammation of the adipose tissue. So three distinct mechanisms have been proposed to link obesity to insulin resistance and development of type 2 diabetes. One is the increased production of inflammatory adipocytokines. There is ectopic deposition of fat, particularly in liver, skeletal muscle, and pancreas, which leads not only to development of insulin resistance as well as leads to development of beta cell dysfunction. And third is mitochondrial dysfunction, which leads to increase in oxidative stress. And this oxidative stress stimulates on one side pathways of insulin resistance, on the other side leads to development of beta cell dysfunction, and also activates the pathways of diabetes complications. There is a strong possibility that both obesity and type 2 diabetes share a common underlying defect, and these defects favor not only weight gain and insulin resistance, but also contribute to beta cell dysfunction. So possibly the ongoing exposure to excessive nutrient concentration at cellular level, which is more than the energy requirements of the cells, leads to deleterious effects of this nutrient access, leading to increased stress in the endoplasmic reticulum, increased production of free radicals, mitochondrial dysfunction, and setting the chain of cascade reactions leading to insulin resistance and diabetes. I will not go through the epigenetic factors. It has been discussed already, but we all know Barker hypothesis. Barker first proposed that in utero metabolic adaptations refine a trajectory of growth that prepares the fetus for likely adult environment. And what happens to fetus in utero depends on mother's and father's behavior during conception and during mother's pregnancy. So possibly undernutrition in pregnancy led to adaptation in the fetus to expect a scarce resource environment. But when the fetus was born, the baby met the obesogenic environment, and the whole story changed, leading to development of obesity. And there are multiple factors which can have this epigenetic effect during pregnancy. So diabetes epidemic is basically caused by genetic predisposition, epigenetic programming, overnutrition, decreased physical activity, and all these are playing a very complex role in causation of obesity and diabetes, and leading to increasing prevalence of this twin epidemic of diabetes. Now, how we manage diabetes? The principles of management remain same as they are for management of diabetes. Only thing is, now we have to focus on weight as a major component of management, because now there is enough data to show that if we are able to induce weight loss, it will not only help in improving the diabetes control or the glycemic control, it can also lead to reversal of or remission of hyperglycemia to normoglycemia and reduce the risk of further complication. So, all patients with diabetes need to be subjected to behavioral therapy and lifestyle interventions. And this I am not going to go into detail because Dr. Rucha discussed in detail all the things about this. And then we have addition of oral agents, especially metformin for all patients. The preference should be for drugs which are either weight neutral or induce weight loss. And if nothing helps, you have to go for bariatric surgery. There are enough studies which have clearly shown that if you induce 5 to 10% weight loss, there is significant reduction in the risk of type 2 diabetes, there is reduced cardiovascular mortality, there is improvement in lipid profile, reduction in blood pressure, improvement in sleep apnea, and overall improvement in the quality of life. We know that we all have seen this interesting study from Roy Taylor, the DIRECT study, which was published in 2017, clearly showed that if you are able to induce 15% weight loss, almost 46% of the people, get into remission of diabetes. This was type 2 diabetes population with duration of diabetes less than 6 years who were, treated in primary care setting with interventions using very low calorie diets or formula diets given over a period of 2 to 3 months, followed by gradual replacement of normal diet. And the people who lost more than 15% body weight actually had 80%, 86% reversal of or remission of type 2 diabetes. Not only that, follow-up data at 2 years follow-up shows that significant number of these individuals have been able to sustain remission of diabetes. Now, this is a slide which shows, the weight gain potential of various drugs. So we should prefer drugs which are able to induce weight loss. And the preferred drugs in this class are, of course, in addition to metformin, the GLP-1 receptor agonists or SGLT2 inhibitors. If person is not able to, take any of these, then other options are AGIs and DPP-4 inhibitors, which should be the preferred drugs. We know GLP-1 receptor agonists now have a fantastic data, and they have a composite benefit of achieving euglycemia without weight gain and without causing hypoglycemia, and should be the preferred drugs. And they cause this by majorly by the central hypothalamic effect by reducing appetite, but they also lead to reduction in the gastric emptying. And there are a number of studies from different GLP-1 receptor agonists showing the weight loss potential of these drugs in addition to significant reduction in the A1C levels. The first drug to be exclusively studied for weight management or management of obesity is liraglutide 3 milligrams, which was studied in non-diabetes obese individuals and showed a significant weight loss. But the things have changed now and we have much better drugs. Liraglutide lowered the energy intake by only 16%. Now, data from semaglutide has clearly shown that reduces energy intake much more significantly to the tune of 35%. It reduces appetite, reduces food craving, has acts by a central mechanism and involves, this central mechanism, which involves both hypothalamus and midbrain. We have 4-step studies in place which have looked at the weight reduction using oral with the injectable semaglutide 2.4 milligrams given once a week. And all studies have clearly shown that you can achieve a weight loss in the range of 17 to 18 kg or about 15% in obese patients without diabetes. And in obese individuals with diabetes, again, you are able to achieve a weight reduction in the range of 11 to 12%. In addition, if you look at the percentage of individuals achieving significant weight loss, almost 86% achieve more than 5% weight loss and 70% achieve more than 10% weight loss. In addition, those individuals who lose more than 10% weight are also having a A1C reduction in the range of 2.2%, which is very, very significant. Other beneficial effects which go beyond weight loss or weight regulation is the improvement in cardiovascular risk factor with reduction in blood pressure, improvement in the hsCRP level, improvement in glycemic control, and overall benefit in quality of life. Not only that, step 4 showed that ongoing therapy with semaglutide led to a sustained reduction of weight, which is which otherwise tends to go up once you discontinue the therapy. Neeta also mentioned about tirzepatide, which is a dual GIP1 GLP1 receptor agonist. It is a multifunction peptide based on the native GIP1 peptide sequence and studies. There is a series of studies with the tirzepatide SURPASS trials, which have clearly shown that leads to a significant reduction in A1C in the range of 2 to 2.5%. In addition, there is almost 11 to 12% weight reduction in patients treated with tirzepatide. It has not yet been approved for management of diabetes or obesity. Now, there is a obesity management clinical trial program in place called SURMOUNT, and it is going to be further studied for management of obesity. If nothing else is working, bariatric surgery is still a good option, and studies have clearly shown that bariatric surgery can induce remission of diabetes in a significant number of patients. So to end my presentation, the take home is that diabetes is possibly the biggest epidemic affecting humans in the current century. Managing obesity is imperative now in all type 2 diabetes patients. It is not the management of hyperglycemia which should take priority. I think it is the management of obesity which should take priority over everything else in management of type 2 diabetes. And we have enough data now that optimum management of obesity can lead to even remission of type 2 diabetes. If not remission, significant improvement in hyperglycemia as well as cardiovascular risk in these patients with diabetes. So the perspective of management needs to be changed, needs to change in as far as the diabetes management is concerned. Thank you very much. I hope I have finished in time.